Welcome to the Brian Murray Show, a real estate show, New Jersey style. Today's discussion point is recycling. It's very controversial, but we have to get into it anyway. So, in Hoboken, if you haven't heard, a couple of months ago, back in September, they went to what's called dual stream recycling, where I guess the plastics are in one part and then the paper is in the other. The key about recycling is that for people to do it, it has to be easy to understand and it has to be easy to do. And, you know, this is the paper here with all the explanations of what you have to do for the recycling. And it's like, okay, so plastics, it's only numbers 1, 2, and 5, which begs the question, what happened to number 3 and number 4? And why is it 1, 2, and 5? I can't remember that. Can I remember 1, 2, and 3? Yes, I could. So why don't they make 5, 3, and 3, 5, and this way we can recycle 1, 2, and 3, if you can even find it. I don't know about you, but I've looked through my little plastics all the time, and that little triangle with the number in it, it's super hard to read if you can even find it. So it's got to be easy to do. That's not easy to do. Then there's a whole list of other things that they want you to do or not want you to do. Like, well, you've got to remove caps and rinse and dry things. And, you know, at this point, I've gone through 8 other steps in order to just recycle something that at the end of the day, the jury is still out on whether recycling is super effective or not in terms of the cost management. So now I've wasted water, I've probably wasted paper towels just to get the thing cleaned, not to mention the countless hours that could be going into something more productive. So it's not easy to do, it's not easy to understand. For instance, this is my Starbucks cup here, and you know, okay, so with this thing here, I'm not sure if the cup itself can be recycled or the little, I'm pretty sure maybe the plastics, the paper sleeve can be, but it's got a lot of print on it. And the cup's got all kinds of print on it, so I'm not sure. And then the lid is, you'd think that it would be, but apparently it's not recyclable. I don't even see a little tag on there that says recyclable. But, you know, just in general, you can say, hey, oh, it's plastic, I'll recycle it. But it's not a 1, a 2, or a 5. So don't do it. It says no lids, no pizza boxes, which are cardboard, but I don't get that because you want to, it says cardboard right here, but then no pizza boxes down here. So now I don't know which plastics I can recycle, which cardboards I can recycle. I know I can't recycle styrofoam. That's a pretty given one already. And then plastic bags. Well, we don't even get plastic bags here in Hoboken, so why do you even put that on there? You won't let me have a plastic bag, then don't put it on here. It just aggravates me that when I go to the Kings that I have to put all the groceries in my pockets because I forgot my recycling bag. Anyway, this was the discussion point on recycling. Today's hot topic, noise. Recently, I found out that I personally am very sensitive to noise. I took some, they were kind of like personality tests, but it turns out that they told me that I was also very attuned to noises. So not so much sensitivity, but I pay a lot of attention to crazy little noises like door squeaks and things like that. So when people are buying a home, one of the big things they're concerned about is noise from above or on the sides. The construction can have a lot to do with that, such as steel and concrete versus wood construction and how much the noise travels. But other things you really want to consider if you have a sensitivity to noise or it does bother you even in the slightest, how close is the elevator to your front door? A lot of times, you know, if you stayed in a hotel and you stayed near the elevator, you'll hear people, you'll hear the elevator ding, you'll hear the door open, you'll hear the people talking in the hallway. I mean, you might not hear as many people in the hallway at your home as you would maybe in a hotel, but
over time, it does add up. The other thing is, where's the garbage being picked up? I have several clients that, you know, have ended up with homes that the garbage is picked up sort of outside of their window. So at 2 o'clock in the morning, you hear the compactor going and the guys throwing the stuff into the truck. For me, that would drive me crazy. I would not last there a week. Other people, they don't even hear it. Other things like the fancy homes on the waterfront, they all complain about helicopter noise. Now, that's something you never even thought about. You come in there, you see a beautiful view of Manhattan and your really prestigious building, and you don't realize that you're gonna be buzzed by helicopters day and night. And if noise bothers you, that might just bother you. Things like stop signs on the corner where you'll hear people's brakes can also be a thing when you have noise. So those are some things to consider. The good news is that, you know, when I used to live on a street that had a lot of fire trucks that would go up and down, and after a while, you just tune those out. Never even hear them anymore. You get visitors that would come over and go, oh my gosh, you hear that fire truck? And you're like, what are you talking about? Because they happen so often that you have to have a coping mechanism. So if you do have a coping mechanism, that's great news. And if you don't, then you need to really start to make a list of all the things that you can't live with. And, you know, when we're looking at apartments, make sure that we can check the box on all of those. This is today's Hot Topic.
This is Brian Murray with Ask the Expert. I'm here with Hemish Kapadia, CPA. And we're talking about today, for those investors out there, before the end of this year, the 2019 year finishes off, are there things that an investor can do who owns investment property that they might want to consider doing to be able to lower their tax burden as a, you know, before the end of this year?
From an investor standpoint, there are things that they can try to plan for. And I say that word because you can look at your rental income, your rental losses. If you're buying into something new toward the end of the year, you might want to put on rent earlier than later to offset the income and loss accordingly. The other side of it is looking at your 1031s. So if you've sold something that you put into 1031, you might look at opportunity zone funding to defer taxes that way, or make sure you're within deadline timelines to make that 1031 actually occur correctly.
Okay. And in terms of, you know, I know that there are things that are considered a capital expense versus a repair, where they get taxed at different times. Are there particular projects that maybe that might lower the taxes sooner rather than later?
I mean, you have options in terms of capital expensing. So if you do have to do the heavy things, such as equipment purchasing for air conditioners, etc., you may want to look at that throughout the year or closer toward the end of the year, where you know what the rental income is, because you can write the full amount off using Section 179 deductions. Also understand the difference between repair and capital, because a repair is really a replacement of an item. So if it's something like a small heater, a bedroom set, all of that could technically be considered repair, including appliance repairs.
Okay, great. This is Ask the Expert.
The good, the bad, the ugly, recycle special. The good, DocuSign, or eSign, .loop, all of the online e-signature programs. You know, in the old days of real estate, you know, the fax machine or even the email days of real estate, where you had to take a contract, and I would have to mail that contract, email that contract over to a client, and then they would sign, they would print it out, and they would sign it, and then they would scan it and send it back to me. And then I would have to print it and then create a copy for my files. So there was a lot of extra paper just for a lease or something for sale. Today, with the DocuSign or the eSign or with those any electronic signature apps, that's all gone. It's just click, 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 easy peasy, super fast. It's fast, it saves paper, it's a win. So that's the good. The bad. So why are we just recycling paper and plastic? I mean, it seems to me there's a lot of things that are easier to recycle or you know, better to recycle, like furniture. You see all this furniture being thrown away where, hey, it's got a little broken chair leg or something like that, where it's simple, a screw, you know, in the right place and the thing works, or a little patch on the fabric and it's as good as new. But people are just throwing this stuff away, and it takes up a lot of space in the landfill, and it's very, very usable stuff, and it's got some value, unlike the Starbucks coffee cup. So that is bad, that, you know, we need to find a better way of really addressing some of these recycle opportunities that we have. And then the ugly. And I'm going to point out my bank on this one. This is PNC Bank. You know, I just had a refi of my mortgage. At one point during the refi, I got 12 packets this thick in separate envelopes, so they were mailed separately, this thick of paperwork that came to me, two a day for an entire week. I finally packed them up, put them in a bag, brought them back to the bank and said, you guys have to recycle these because I can't shred all of these. My shredder's going to bust. And it's just ridiculous that, you know, the amount of paper that they wasted on a minor change, that, and they said two a day, every day for a week. That is the ugly. PNC, clean up your act.
Inspiration. Once you need less, you have more. Thanks for watching The Brian Murray Show. If you found any of this information useful, please reach out to me and follow me on YouTube, Instagram, Facebook, any other social media that you can think of. Your comments are always welcome. And if there's something that you don't agree with, let me know and I'll show you why you're wrong.